comes the empty grave. Like eternal, you have won the day. Down and out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You are smiling. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never reach a day.
Good morning. Well, man, you guys are alive. I said good morning earlier at first service, and they just kept talking, but not to me. So it was nice. You guys said good morning and loud. So welcome to church. So blessed that you guys could be here today. We are going to honor seniors, okay? Excited for that. I know there's a couple that are running behind, all right? they'll be here soon. But as I'm talking, the ushers are going to go ahead and do offering. And then I'll thank the Lord for it and pray for it and all that when I go in to pray, okay? Is that Christian up there? What's up, Christian? How you doing, man? It's good to see you. Haven't seen that guy forever. Welcome to church. There's a couple announcements before we get into honoring seniors. July 5th, want to baptize people in the river. So if you've had a desire to get baptized, would love to baptize you, okay? So talk to myself, Pastor Mark, and we will make sure that happens. So that's July 5th after this service. So looking forward to that. There is, Jane, I forgot to mention it, but there's been some people asking about the Daily Bread books and things like that. She said it's in the mail, okay? So if you've been looking for those, she wanted to make sure that I let you guys know that they're coming, and she hopes that they'll be here for Wednesday service, okay? Other than that, I did want to let you know we aren't having rowdies upstairs today, but if you have a student in that age range, I have donuts for them, okay? So if it's 6th through 8th grade and want a pack of donuts, I would love to give them to you for that, okay? So people keep coming in, which is good, wonderful, excited. There is lots of prayer requests. I always feel like I say that really wrong, but here's some people that just need our prayers, okay? If you'll remember them, just some really tough things going on. In people's lives, there's tough stuff going on in your guys' life. So if ever have a prayer request, let us know. But here are some of the ones that, since we don't have a bulletin, just want to get up there on the board, okay? Gordon Collinsworth had that surgery and all those things. So here's an address you can send him some mail to. He'd love to hear from you, okay? So he's there. Just excited for Grant and Holly, before you guys sit down, you guys can come down here. I don't want you guys to get comfy, and then I'll say, hey, it's time to come down here. So if you're a senior, you can come down here. We'd love to spend some time with you guys and talk to you, okay? I look at you guys, I see Joseph. Joseph was the man that knocked the water fountain off in the Mega Week a couple years ago. But that's not what I'm going to remember him by. That's not, even though it's a great story, he knocks the water fountain off the wall in the middle of the night, and he felt so terrible about it, and it was this beautiful display of his heart, how much he cared. But I know you have just blessed me in knowing just, man, how caring you are. You're the oldest brother of lots of sisters. And I mean, I'm not at home with you, so I don't see how you treat him at home, but you've always been so nice and so loving. And now you're stepping into worship and playing the bass and doing all sorts of stuff. I've seen you worship with your whole family on stage at one point, pretty much. What a beautiful thing. The Lord has amazing things for you, Joseph. No matter where you're going, what you're doing, it is good. And he'll do something pretty incredible in your life, okay? Believe that, trust that, and take the roof off it, okay? Don't hold back. Don't worry. It'll be all right. It's good. Lucas. You thought you were going to go to Urbana University, right? You thought that was your college and it gets closed. No. And now you're going to a college. You told me, I don't even know how to say the name of it. And I don't know if you said it right there or not, so good job. But I've seen you. You've been passionate about, you're so passionate about cross country and wrestling and baseball. And baseball was taken from you this year. Listen, God has so much for you in your life. Don't let things that were taken from you hold you back, okay? Step forward with all that you have in everything and knowing that God has something pretty special for you, okay? We love you as a church. Look, I feel like, you know, when we baptize people, we say, look at all these people, they're for you. Look at all these people, Lucas, they love you, they support you, they are proud of you, okay? And it's amazing, all right? Bianca, what are you doing back there? Come up here. You're a senior, you graduate. Don't try to hide. Addison, Addison, she was friends with my sister-in-law, right? Megan, did you ever go to LifeNet? Or did you come just to this youth group? So she came with my sister-in-law years and years ago, but like 5 or 6 years ago when me and Lachelle first started youth ministry, and here she is again, you know, to finish off her school, to come to church, and no one's making you come here, right? You're coming because you're God's calling you near. You're coming to really seek, and we're proud of you, okay? We know that you can go and do amazing things, okay? I don't even remember you're going to school for something with skin, and you sound way smarter than me, but the church is for you, okay? We're proud of you. God has a perfect plan for your life. Don't lose sight of that. And when you can go for it, you're coming now and you're seeking. God's word says you draw near to him and he'll draw near to you. That's his promise. So don't forget that. Don't think he's far off. Don't think he's not in your life. He's right here, right now for you. Okay? We love you. We're proud of you. I'll get to you, Bianca. I can't believe you were trying to hide. That's yeah, it's okay. I get it. Trenton. A baby growling for you. Proud of you, man. Proud of you. West Point. What'd you have to do to go there? A lot of stuff. Wow. What an amazing thing. Wow. Wow. You're so capable of so many things. You have a pretty amazing family, don't you? That's a blessing. That's so good. He had to do some community service. He's asked me to write some letters of recommendation, and things, and community service that built up to this point, to trying to get accepted to West Point. And I think of the time he was cleaning the youth room, and I gave him these instructions, and he did a pretty, his brother was there too. I think he was trying to keep him in line. I don't know. That's a dispute for later. But I remember he was just proud of the small stuff. Like I asked him to do certain things, like put zip ties around the lights, and then I asked him to sweep off our stage upstairs, and our stage is black. And so any dust, any dirt, you see it all the time. But I don't know. I feel like he was super proud of just how clean the stage looked, because I remember I wasn't up there. When I got back up there, he's like, look at the stage. Does it look good? I was like, I don't think it's ever looked that good in my life since I've been here. And so I don't know. I just feel like the Lord is saying, if you pay attention to the small things, he will bless your life tremendously. And it does. And when you can focus in on those things, that's where God will begin to expand you in so many ways, and just continue to focus like that, and you'll be on the right path, okay? We're proud of you. We love you. Excited, man, West Point. Can't wait to hear some stories and all that you're doing, and stay connected, okay? We love you. Bianca, I'll sneak over here. Don't look at me. You can look at me if you want, but they're going to cheer you on. That was rude. I'm sorry. You can look back here. It's okay. proud of you, Bianca. You still work at Subway? Unfortunately. hopefully your boss isn't in here or anything. So I need you to promise me subs for life, and I won't tell him, I promise. No. But you've been coming to church. It's been pretty amazing to see. You've been pretty faithful. I know you've walked through some hard things that you've been struggling with, but you've been working through it, and you've been seeking the Lord, and which is the greatest thing you could ever do. And what an accomplishment, standing here on the stage and graduating high school and getting that chapter in your life to this point, all that you've been working for, right, up to this point in your life, you did it. We're proud of you. I just want to encourage you to when God calls you to something, step in it with confidence, okay? Do it with all that you have. You can't go wrong. Don't lose sight that God's in control. He has you, and he will do something in your life that others will see and be like, wow, what is going on with that girl? in a good way, you know, in an amazing way. You will bring glory to God's kingdom, to his throne. And what an amazing opportunity, an amazing thing. And I know anytime I see you, I'm always excited because I just think you're such an amazing person, okay? So we're proud of you. The church loves you. Can't wait to see. I need to know what you're doing with your life. I'm sorry.
I'm going to college for forensic psychology to be a victim's advocate.
All right, victims. So you're for people. You want to help them out. All right. See, I could put some pieces together. That's pretty amazing. So that shows you got a heart for people. That's good. Proud of you. So church, let's pray, okay? Let's pray for them. And I know I get guilty of this sometimes when Mark's praying, but I challenge you, encourage, if God's put someone on your heart, not to come up here and pray, but pray for that person, pray for that student, and lift them up, and pray for specific things, because we've all been in this place, either graduating or not, where we're taking the next step in our life, and we know how difficult and how bad things are to come. So as a church, let's pray for them, and I'm going to have you celebrate them one more time, okay? So, Father, we're grateful. We just thank you, God, for these kids. God, as they've grown up in this place and come and go, Lord, here they are now, and they're here for a reason, Lord. So, God, I pray that you would just touch their heart. I pray, God, that you would pour into them now just your peace. God, your confidence, Lord, your desire, your will for their life, God. Let it be clear and knowing, God, that when they seek you, they will find you. And when they lift things up to you, you hear them. You don't ignore them. God, you see them. You love them. You know them. You've loved them from the very beginning of time. So, Lord, we just ask a special blessing upon these students, God. Lord, we lift them up to you, God, as this season has been some seasons of no's. God, I pray, Lord, that you would reveal some yeses in their life today, tomorrow, over the next few weeks, over the next few months. Lord, let it be good. Let it be amazing. Let them just feel your love, God. Let them feel your support. God, let them feel your goodness. So, Lord, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you for each and every one of them, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, come on, church. Celebrate them. All right, here you go. Yes, don't fall. Quit laughing at me, Noah. I know, you're not laughing at me. Your grandpa was, though, because I guess Lachelle posted a video of me being stuck in my car. But it's okay. And everyone's like, why didn't you climb out the back door that was open? Because it doesn't work that well when you're my size, okay? And I had a bucket of water and it. But anyway, so come on down or come on up here, seniors. Would love to just talk to you guys and let the church see you guys and honor you guys, okay? So, yep, here we go. There we go. There's Grant, you can stay down there. You're tall enough, okay? Yeah. So yeah, yep. Keep on coming, guys. I'm trying, trying to make sure we got everybody. Yeah. Oh, he's taller than me. No, we already know it. He's taller than me. I still got you. I'm just joking. I don't think that's the truth. So he just keeps getting taller. So yeah, here are some of the graduates, okay, from the church. We've seen them, grow up. They've been around, and so just excited for you guys, okay. As a church, we love you. We're proud of you. Yeah, that's good. That's real good. And just so that way that they can get to know you, name, age, school, and what's your plan, okay. For the next steps in life. I'll hold the microphone.
I'm Austin Rooney. I'm 18 years old. I go to Urbana High School, or went to Urbana High School, and I plan on going to the University of Cincinnati for aerospace engineering.
All right, that's good.
My name's Leanna. I'm 18. I just graduated yesterday from Urbana High School, and I'm hoping to go to the University of Akron next year for environmental sciences.
My name's Holly Camper. I am 18. I graduated from Graham, and I plan on going to Sinclair Community College for dental hygiene next year.
I'm Adrienne Blanken. I'm 17 years old, and I went to Graham and also Ohio High Point Career Technical School for my cosmetology license, and I'll be attending Clark State in Springfield for the first 2 years and then transferring for a business international degree in something at somewhere, so I'm not sure yet. But
you can do it.
My name's Kenneth. I went to Triad. I don't know what my future plans are yet. I work construction right now. I'll be doing that for a few years, so that's about it.
That's good. That's good.
My name's Grant Hauer. I went to Urbana High School, and I'll be going to Ohio State next year and majoring in early childhood education.
All right. Early childhood education. So that's all so exciting. I typically try to ask God what he would have me say to you guys, because I pray that you know my heart for each and every one of you, and the church's heart, and God's heart, and that absolutely adores you guys. You guys have made it to a place that if you look at the world, that not a lot of kids have the opportunity to do. All your life has been brought to this point to graduate, to celebrate, to you did it, you made it. And something that God has been putting on my heart the last couple weeks, just thinking of this day to come, to get to speak to you guys, to get the church to see you guys, and that is God just wants you to know just that he's faithful, and he loves you, and scripture that he put on my heart for you guys is in Luke chapter 5. One day Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." So here are these men carrying someone that was paralyzed, and everyone was around because they heard what Jesus was doing. He was healing people, and Jesus was speaking to the Pharisees and just trying to teach his heart. His disciples were there, and these guys couldn't get through. They were told no. No, you can't come in. No, 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 no. You guys have been told no the last couple months. No, you can't do this last thing that you've been looking forward to. No, you can't have typical graduations. No, and things haven't been picture perfect in your mind. These men were told no, but they found a way. They took this guy that was paralyzed on a mat up to the roof. Not only up there, they started breaking through the roof, removing tiles, removing the thing that was separating them from Jesus. And because of their faith, because of what they did, because of not allowing the no the world was telling them, he was healed. He was forgiven. He was forgiven of his sin. And then the Pharisees didn't like that answer. Who are you to say you can forgive sin? No. But Jesus says, listen, I can do that. I am the one. And I tell you to get up and walk and go. The world will try to tell you no every single step of your life. Don't let it. Listen, the Lord has good, amazing things for each and every one of you guys. I've seen it happen already. I've seen beautiful things come from the Lord in each one of your lives. I started on this side last time, but I'll start down here. So Grant, man, I have a picture upstairs. I have, maybe it's just the stuff I've accumulated over the years, but you were just a small little guy. You weren't this giant of a man. Mike, you're a man now. Yeah, I'm a man, Justin. But I've watched you grown. grow up, and I've seen you, oh man, play basketball. I've had so much fun just doing those things with you. I don't know what it is, but I remember that day we played basketball out here and you guarded me and I drained like two right in your face. And you're like, what is this? Like, why is this possible? And I'm like, I won't do it now because you're way taller than me. but you're like, I don't get it. Why is it? But no, just to hear that you're stepping into early childhood education, man, speaks to the desires of just a gentle nature and wanting to see kids rise up and to have something that's amazing for them. And so, man, just proud of you. It's so cool to see, and you're going to OSU, and it's pretty amazing. And I know this, that God has incredible things for you in your life. You know, I know as a big person, like tall, everyone was like, man, if I was your size, I would be doing this thing or that. And all these expectations would get put on me thinking that I should be LeBron James, you know. And it's like, come on, there's only one LeBron James. It's not me, clearly. But what's so amazing is that in that, we don't have to compare ourselves to anybody. The only thing that we need to receive is from the Lord. And if we can tune into that and dive into that with everything, man, God will rise us up and make us giants in our faith in him. And it's something amazing and powerful and strong that only comes from the Lord. So we love you. We're proud of you. The church is excited of who you are and what you're becoming and what you're doing, okay? We're for you. Love you. Yeah. Kenny is giving me the death stare. Kenny, proud of you, man. Yeah, yeah. There's you've went through some difficult things, but here you stand. And you know why? Because God has an amazing plan for your life. Mark told me that you just bought a car. How cool, right? How cool. I don't want to embarrass him, but just it's exciting because I remember when I got my first car, I couldn't wait to drive it. And Kenny hasn't got his license yet, and so I've heard him he's been driving around Mark's parking lot. How exciting that is! Like that's not anything to shrug your shoulders at. Man, you bought a car. That's an accomplishment. You graduated high school. You did it when the world was telling you no. When the circumstances were hard, you stand here today, a graduate of high school, and we're proud of you. The Lord is proud of you. Okay, it is good. You hear that? Man, like, they're cheering for you, Kenny. You smile. I'm going to eat that steak Mark's getting you. When's Mark getting you that steak?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know. You shouldn't lie in the church, Kenny. Okay, he's being serious. Soon. All right. So, Kenny, man, we're 2 months from now. Okay. No. So, we're proud of you, man. Okay. God's proud of you. You did it. You made it. And the amazing thing is God's not through yet. He is not finished with you. And when you can be in a position to receive from him, the only place is to go up. No matter how hard life may be, God is continuing to elevate you to a place where you can glorify him. Believe in that, trust in that, and know that you were purposed for so much more than the hardness that you face in your life. All right? Love you. Proud of you. Yeah. You don't have to stare at me more, Kenny. I can't even talk now because you're staring me down so hard. I'm going to face this way so I don't have to be intimidated. Adrian. So proud of you. And I mean that with everything. You're a hard worker. You work hard. You've been so busy. But busy working, you don't hear that a lot of times from kids your age, adults your age, young adults your age. But you had a desire. You have a heart that just wants to. You're trying to do right. You're seeking. You're finding. I heard that your testimony from your trip to Africa. Wow! Like God is doing an amazing work in your life, and He has so much for you. You know, when the pandemic started, I knew she cut hair. I'm like, hey, can you cut Cole's hair? because it was so long already, and that was 2 months ago. And but she came and she cut his hair up in the youth room, and we had a little barber shop because we had barber stools. It was a blessing. And I want you to know, God thinks and knows that you're a blessing. I don't know why, like, it just hit me so hard. You're a blessing, Adrian, in this world, in this life, to people, to your mom, to your sisters, to your family. You are a blessing. And God is proud of you. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever let anything try to take that away from you. You are a blessing, and God sees your heart. And God's word is that he will delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. And I've seen that in these last, you know, years I've got. You've always been willing to help. You've always been a blessing. And God did some pretty tremendous things to give you an amazing testimony in your life. The power of your testimony is amazing and good, okay? So we love you. The church is proud of you. Yeah. What's up, Holly? We got to do a hand hug. There's some hand sanitizer right there, okay? Holly, you have been, I've seen, she's, how do you say it, salutatorian? Salutatorian for Graham. All right, that's pretty impressive. I've seen a genuine love in your heart for the Lord. There's something about you. Whenever you come around, like, no matter what you're walking through, you just are uplifting. You are just somebody that's so, just a breath of fresh air. Like, I'm trying to think in my mind and my heart how to best explain you, but you are just, it is, I know Mark said this about Cheryl Cruz one day, anything you touch is good, or she's like a fragrance that is just so special and good, and Holly, you are special and good, and God has just the world for you, and I have seen whatever you set your mind to, whatever you set your heart to, you've achieved it, and you've wanted it, and you've gotten it. And I know this, there was some something that, I guess the biggest thing that with you and I this past couple months, you had your heart set on Peru, and it wasn't looking good for you just with some things, but God worked it all out, because I know this summer we're not able to go, which it breaks our hearts. But when we allow God just to move in the ways he wants to move, the things that we are positioning right in front of us that are an obstacle or hurdle will be something that we can just go right over when we trust in him. And so I just am proud of you. I it's so amazing to see who you become in your heart and in your life, and just your desire to bring people to know who the Lord is, a desire to invite people to church, a desire just to be around, and I appreciate it. The church loves you. We just see you, how hard you've worked, and it's just pretty special and amazing, okay? Yeah, just, you can do it, all right? You can do it. Hi, Leanna. How you doing? I'm doing well. Thank you for telling me. That's good. I appreciate it. Leanna, you're full of life. You are full of energy. You're full of, I don't think I've ever really seen you down. Like, I know you've been upset about things, but I've never seen you get to a place to where you're completely crushed or defeated. And you just keep moving. You just keep going. You just keep walking forward. And I just have enjoyed that spirit about you. You feel young, youthful, and I like that, because that makes me feel a little bit younger. I sat down upstairs next to Kyle Hunt, and I was like, we both said, oh, it was at the same time, like, man, does that mean we're getting older or something? but anytime I'm around you, you make me feel young. And I know this. I enjoy the fact that you have never rushed getting older. you've always just enjoyed being a kid, being a youth, but now you're growing up and God has amazing things for you. You did amazing. I enjoyed watching you play in the marching band. That was always such a good time, and it was a blessing. And God has so much for you in your life. Don't ever think that he doesn't, okay? We love you. We're proud of you. We're your biggest fans, okay? And come back around so we can feel young. Now I know how it feels. Yeah, I don't even know what I was going to say now. But now I feel, I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about you. He always beats me in ping pong. I'm so mad because you don't have to rub it in. I already said you always beat me, and now you're like every week. It's going to happen. I'm going to beat him. I believe in myself. I'm going to pray every time, Lord. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But Austin, I've enjoyed just seeing you grow up. I've been in your life for the last 5-6 years, and it's been a blessing to see. I feel guilty because when I first started, like, we had lots of other kids, and I didn't remember you from this tubing trip that we took. And you're like, I was there. I was like, what? But but it just shows you how fast time goes. And there's a season for everything. And in this season, I've just seen you be diligent about a lot of things and what you believe in and what your faith is in and what you hold on to. And that's pretty powerful statement about yourself, because our emotions are nuts. If we live by emotions, and unfortunately, there's a lot of things that happen in this world where people are led by emotions and not by the Lord, and it just becomes chaos. But I've seen you be led by the Lord and not by your emotions. Even though the ups and downs are so hard and difficult, you said, I have a faith in the Lord that I don't want to waver from, no matter what. And that's pretty special. And so, Austin, I am so proud of you. The church loves you. They're proud of you. We can't wait to see who you become, who you continue to grow into be. But, man, look, I don't know, this just feels fitting. Look out, Satan. Like, not today, Satan. You know, like, it's not, like, you, he doesn't stand a chance. And God is going to use you in mighty ways in this world, in this life. And so, graduates, we love you. We thank you for just being a part of the church and being faithful and trying to come whenever you can. We have some Bibles and candy and some journals. If you don't write in journals, I'll say do it because it's good. I write in a journal, and if you say you have a problem with it, talk to Austin. But church, let's pray for them, okay? Pray for them and their life as they go from this place to new places and new places and choices and decisions that they make. So, Lord, we're so grateful, God, for each and every one of these seniors. God, as everything that they've been working up to at this point in their life is coming, this chapter is coming to an end. And God, we celebrate them, we rejoice them, God. I pray that they would know that you're proud of them and that they have done a good job. Lord, I pray for protection over each one of them, God, as they take these next steps in their life, that they would seek you for guidance, that they would not just live by their emotions, Lord, but they would live and long to love you, Lord, that they would not accept the no's of this world, God, but they would do whatever they had to seek your face, to be in your presence, to live a life that you have called them to live. Yeah, God, so we're proud of them. We lift them up to you, Lord. We ask that your spirit would just come lay some peace on them. Come, Lord, just let them know how much they're loved. Yeah, God, so we thank you. We thank you for each and every one of them, Lord. Thank you for Grant. Thank you for Kenny. Thank you for Adrian. Thank you for Holly. Thank you for Leanna. And thank you for Austin. And all the other ones that couldn't make it today, Lord, we're so grateful for them. And we just lift them up to you. In Jesus, let me pray. Amen. All right, hey, love you guys. We got some Bibles for you. Here you go. Hello. All right, there we are. I'm going to actually pray real fast for worship and offering and all that stuff and the prayer request, and then we're going to go for it, okay? So, Father, we're grateful. We're so thankful for who you are. We thank you, God, that we could come together and have this place just filled with joy, God, as we honor and celebrate the seniors. So, Lord, we love you. We thank you. We ask that you would bless the offering that we've collected, Lord, and just that your will would be done. God, and just all the prayer requests, God, you know them. Lord, I pray that as we have those things, we would lift them up to you. Lord, we would never forget to turn to you first and know, God, that you make a way. Lord, so we thank you for this time. We welcome your Holy Spirit to just come fill this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to church. So if you'd stand and we'll worship, and what a beautiful, beautiful weekend we've had. It's gorgeous. And we're about to sing Holy Water. And, you know, and we have a baptism coming up in July. And so just think about that. You know, most of you have probably already been baptized. And if you haven't, make sure that you get in there in July. But Holy Water, and we come up out of that water, and God says in his word, be holy because I am holy. So let's think about, what are we doing? What are we saying? What are we watching? What are we listening to? What are we reading? Okay? And let's just not just accept Jesus as our Savior, but let's embrace this Jesus life. Okay?
Your grace, God, I need it every day. like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water.
Our blessings. And you know, that's something in people, I think that's the answer to this crazy time that we're living in. You know, it's just something. Every, you know, we got the COVID thing and then everything else is going on. And but you know, we still have so many things to be thankful for. So start your day you know, counting your blessings. And, you know, I spend time every morning with the Lord and I count my blessings. And as the day goes on, I get a little more, you know, stressed and things are going on and I'm very busy with work. And by the end of the day, I can start being a little discouraged. So I'm going to start doing more evening time with the Lord. I'm going to start doing more thankful time with the Lord in the evening, too. There's a Bible verse in the Bible that talks about spending time with the Lord day and evening. So, if you would join me doing that, thanks.
I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. But you were my Redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruin to treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure.
Storm and gale, I am
Hosanna in the
We praise you, Lord, for our graduates, Lord. Thank you so much for this generation that's rising up, Lord, to carry on your work, to shine your light, Lord. We're so thankful. God, we are blessed, Lord. Our church is blessed, Lord. And Father, there's a lot of craziness going on in this world, but you've got it all under control. Let us not lose sight of that. And Lord, you are here for us, and you are not forsaking us, and you will use everything for your glory. Lord, help us to just serve, to love, and to not quit, Father, not quit. And Lord, we just look forward to, as you fall down on our church, as you rain down blessings and miracles on our church, as we go out and share, Lord, all about you and the love that you have for every single one of us. Jesus died on the cross for us, and that was the most amazing love ever. But Lord, I see just you in the little things. God, it just amazes me. I'm so thankful. We love you. Bless Pastor Mark as he comes. I heard his message this morning. It's awesome. And I pray that everybody celebrates his message with him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, 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 hello. Hello, 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 hello. Hello, 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 hello. Yeah, hey, good morning. Good to see everybody. Thanks for coming to church. Wasn't that music good? Yeah. Dana, that music's good. Tell everybody for us. We're very appreciative. Would you do that? Yeah? Very nice. All them high school graduates, isn't that so cool? Isn't that cool? Man, our kids are better than other churches' kids. Well, I'm just making it, kidding. How's that? My child, how's that go? They used to have those bumper stickers. Are the best. My child beat up your child or something. Okay, good morning. I feel like I want to have fun with you today. I got some hard preaching to do, but you can't take stupid out of this brain right here. You can't fix this thing right here. You just can't do it. So I don't see myself as a normal pastor at all. So if you're trying to look at me as a normal pastor, that ain't going to work for you, okay? So, but I did find myself hanging out in Haggai today. You know what I mean? Haggai, can you believe that? I'll tell you a story. I have struggled so hard this week to figure out what the right verses are. And at times I'm like, God, what's wrong with you? He knows I'm a jokester too. He knows it's okay. But last night I was in here and I just struggling to find, and there's something in me. I just know when I'm in the right place and I know when I'm not. There's just something. And I could not find the verses, the right verses, the right thoughts, the right verses. And I went home last night. You can ask my wife. I'm just like, oh, I don't know what's wrong. I got up early this morning, came in here, bang, got them. So here they come. You ready? Feel real excited about what God has for us today. Super, super excited. So it's Pentecost Sunday. Yeah, pretty excited about that. Just so you know, just so you're the smartest church out there, you know, there's seven major Jewish holidays. There's more, but seven majors. Four in the spring, 3 in the fall, right? The 4 spring holidays in the New Testament have been fulfilled already when Jesus was here. We're waiting on the 3 fall Jewish festivals to be fulfilled in the New Testament. It starts with the Feast of Trumpets in the fall, which is a type of the rapture. So we feel the next fulfillment of a festival, a Jewish festival, is the rapture. But we're on the 4th Jewish festival. It's Pentecost. You might say, Mark, we're not Jews, and you don't listen. We serve a God that works on a Jewish calendar, man. He's the one that gave this stuff, so we better be paying attention. I'm just trying to tell you, that's his calendar. So we got a whole different count, but God's calendar. So Christians ought to be paying attention to that, right? And Pentecost in the Old Testament was the day Moses got the law at Mount Sinai. It was 50 days after they left Egypt. Passover lamb, the whole thing. Well, 50 days after Jesus was Pentecost in the New Testament. I mean, it's so funny how there's a New Testament equivalent to an Old Testament event. It just happens, okay? And it's just wow, wow, wow. And there's still some to be fulfilled, which are still very amazing. But today's Pentecost. In the New Testament, let me say, in the Old Testament, when they got the law, that became really the beginning of the Jewish nation. They pulled them out of Egypt. They were going to be their own nation. They were going to be, and God worked with the Jewish nation. When Pentecost got fulfilled in the New Testament, when the Holy Spirit came down, hey, he started the church. The church. That church. Right? Pretty amazing. Today's Pentecost Sunday. You're going to see some verses today about Pentecost Sunday. You're going to see some verses going to blow your mind. Like, did I tell you I was hanging out in Haggai? I never hang out in Haggai. That's where the Lord took me today. So we're going to get to some verses here. I got some verses here. Review from last week. It's just what I need. I'm going to do it that way. This is what the pastor needs. We're going to do this real good because I think over time as we review this, we need this. Because, listen, we're the church. We belong to Jesus, right? So we're not getting caught in the things of the world. Right? So we're not going to live by our feelings. We're not going to live by all the, we're not going to be gloom and doom. We're not going to get caught in all that. We're not going to, God is working in everything. He works everything together for good. We know that whole thing. I can trust you, Lord, right? Repeating to myself, I can trust you, Lord. I can trust you, Lord. In everything, I can trust you. You make everything work together for good. Right? Someday I'll be with you forever. So this thing I'm going through right now isn't no big deal because someday I'm going to be with you forever. Did I say forever? I don't know if you guys caught forever. Did you catch forever? That's a long time. So this momentary thing that I'm going through right now, you need to be reminded that this is just for a minute and it's going to be okay because God works everything together for good. And if we don't lose heart, I'll show you the verses. Therefore, this is review from last week. We're going to get to the Haggai in just a minute. Okay? Therefore, don't lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inner man is being renewed day by day. Does anybody need that? Does anybody need that? Don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. An angel, it's a long story, an angel whipped around, pointed his finger at my wife because she needed a good finger pointing about 2 years ago and looked at her and said, don't stop what you're doing. And busted out the door. A reminder, if God called you to something, hey, if God's called you, the enemy's doing everything in the world to bust it up, right? But don't lose heart. How do we get through it? God will renew you day by day. Okay, keep going here. For our light affliction is but for a moment, is working in far more exceedingly eternal weight of glory. Everything you're going through, I know some things are harder than others, right? Some people today are experiencing hard things. It's just for a little while. I tell people all the time when they've had somebody close to them die, you're just 5 minutes behind. I don't think that's always that encouraging, but the truth is, it's just for a moment. It's just for a moment. A lady that was in our our church last week, Phoebe, Lauren Salyer's mom, she was here last week, is over in Riverside. They're telling her she's ate up with stomach cancer, and we're sad. We're supposed to have some tests tomorrow, some more things, but everything all of a sudden, suddenly is very bad. And I was trying to remind Lauren this morning, Lauren, the beautiful thing is through it all, Phoebe's coming to the Lord. She's been just a faithful, if you know Phoebe, you can call her at the hospital. I'll give you her number. And you can call over and talk to her. She just, nobody can get in to see her. But all this stuff will pass away. It's really not that big deal when it compares to what's happening. What says right there? For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working in for us a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory, right? Get it? We talked about this last week. I don't want to bog down here too much, okay? While we do not look at the things which are seen, you know, there's a presumption here by Paul, hey, that you Christians aren't even supposed to be worried about what you're seeing. For we don't look at what we see. We're not. We know there's a spiritual thing behind that, right? This whole idea that there's two parallel narratives going on. There's what you see and then what God's doing. There's two things going on at the same time all the time. You get that? Everybody get that? You get that? Woo! There's what you see and there's what God's doing. And you Christians got to get your eyes on what God's doing, not what you see. Because what you see can bum you out. Right? So funny, and I'm not. We have one superstar in our church. You know who that? You know who that is? We got one superstar in our church, a fella named Travis, right? And I bet when his mom birthed him, she thought, "Oh no, what's this going to be? What's going to happen here?" To realize he's amazing. You know what I mean? And so I'm just trying to give you an illustration of this idea that what you see with your eyes isn't. Travis is one of the most uplifting, fun, laughing, great guys in the church. You know what I mean? One of the most amazing. The world doesn't value him like that, but his church family does. You know what I mean? So you can't look at what you see. You got to see the beauty in what God's doing, man. God's doing, God is good. God's glorious. God works everything. Oh, man, it's a man. God, wow, well, big deal. Good God, right? Right? God's good. And God's story about you is good. And God's plan for you is good. You don't know what God has for you. You don't know the plans God has for you. You don't know how God created you for just the time as this. I'm referring to all these Old Testament big lighters, you know. You don't know. What you need to do is have courage, have strength, have heart, you know. Get quiet before the Lord. Hear God's voice. Follow God. Don't get caught in what you see. It's just for a moment. See right here? So we don't look at what's seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary. Things that are not seen are eternal. The two narratives are going on. There's stuff you see. There's stuff God doing. Right? Two narratives going all the time. Everybody get it? Don't you Christians think, well, there's just one thing going on here and it's all bad. No! There's a paralleling God doing what I see. God doing what I see. And you can get caught in, you can make a choice, get caught in either one of them. I added this one. For we do not grow weary doing good. In due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. So if we quit, Kenny's back there. Kenny's like, quit talking about me. He's only up here acting grumpy because he don't like being in front of people. We're very proud of Kenny. Kenny's story has been very tough. Justin did a very good job of telling his story. Just kind of refer. His story has been very tough. Kenny didn't want to do his schoolwork. Kenny's not having a whole lot of success at school in general, right? Because of everything, Kenny's been a handful as a student, right? But guess what? He kept going. He kept going. I told him, kid, at one point, because he's a young man, loves to eat, I thought I'd get to him through his stomach. I said, Kenny, if you'll do your work and get through this thing, I'm gonna find the biggest steak there is. I'm going to find the biggest steak there is for you, and we're going to have one big steak party. And I'm going to dare you to eat the whole thing in one sitting. I'm going to try to get something so big you can't eat it. What? The old 96er. Where's that at? Because I need help. I know there's a big old hamburger thing, but I wouldn't get him a steak. Big old hamburger thing in Bell Fountain, man. They'll pay you money if you eat it. Amarillo, Texas? Kenny, 72-ounce steak, Amarillo, Texas. Let's go, man. After church, let's go. You graduate today. In fact, Jamie said, as soon as I start praying, you're going to bust out of here. You got to get over, catch up with family, go graduate. Lord, you still do miracles. He didn't quit. Right? Didn't quit. What'd you say? Kenny, I can't hear you. You got to be real loud. Three times out loud. What? Close to quitting. Oh, I've been there. You know, I started a church one time. You know how hard that was in the beginning? You know how hard that was in the beginning? I really believe if some things hadn't been broken behind me, I'd have went back. Children of Israel always wanted to go back. They just kept wanting to go back. But God put me out here. I've had to tell myself, I can't quit. God called me. I can't quit God doing this. The ministry we do now, there's times when I say, God, I don't even want to do this. I don't remember the interview. You know? But you called me to this. I've had to say 50 times a day. Because the thought of wanting to kill somebody goes through me a lot. Mark, be patient, be patient, be patient, be patient. I'm starting to say to myself a lot. I'm just teaching myself what to say. Now listen, you all talk to yourself and don't think I'm the only weird guy here. But I'm starting to say to myself, God, I can trust you. God, I can trust you in this. Lord, I'm going to trust you in this. No matter what it is, I can trust you in this, Lord. Right? So, here's what we know. If we quit, we don't get a reap. But if we don't quit, in due season. Now, you got to understand that. You get that thing? Okay, just like in nature, you put a seed in the ground. Wouldn't it be awesome the next day you harvest that? Wouldn't that be amazing? Wouldn't it be put corn seed in the ground, next day come back, oh, look at these ears of corn, man. Right? No. You put a seed in the ground. Guess what happens in the due season? Guess what happens in the due season? Because you have an adversary, right, that doesn't want you to get that harvest. He wants to take that harvest away. You know, that's what the enemy does. He wants to take the harvest away. So in the due season, he's doing everything in the world he can do. Did you say to make you a Democrat? What'd you say? Oh, I thought I heard that. Anyhow. That's just what I thought I heard. Anyhow, in due season. I didn't mean you for funny. Hey, in due season, guess what? What happens when you make it through all the storms? When you make it through all the drought? When you make it through all the stuff? When you make it through all the bugs? When you make it through all the troubles, you know? In nature, we see these spiritual principles all the time, right? But if you don't quit, what's that movie? I need help because I'm only the dude about potatoes. What is it? The dude, Wasn't he a Christian man planting potatoes in the biggest drought? It was like in Africa or something. Preacher, was it Australia? Anyhow, what's the name of that movie? What? Faith Like Potatoes. I'm not a movie watcher. I don't know who even Tom Cruise is. I don't know. But I will tell you that Faith Like Potatoes is a pretty good. He was dead unless he just believed in God that something under the ground was growing in famine, in awful, in dryness, in. And God was faithful in it. Thanks, Steve. I needed help. So when Deucey, this isn't in the preaching. I got to get there. Here's the preaching today. You ready? So if you needed that, that was just something for me. I'm sorry. I think you needed too. But we probably are going to review that a lot here late. Because I think people are getting very discouraged in what they see. And I've got to keep telling you, it's not what you see. There's another narrative. It's what God's doing. You believers need to be in the other narrative, not in what you see. You got it? Okay. Here we go. Here's the preaching this morning. Pentecost, right? Here's a secret. You know, when the Bible says mystery, I always like the verses where the Bible says mystery. So, I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery. I always like reading verses like that because it's like, oh. So Paul's writing to this church at Rome, and Paul's trying to let them know, hey, there's a mystery in some of this. Now, what's this mystery? Least you should be wise in your own opinion. That blindness in part has happened to Israel, to the Jews, until the fullness of the Gentile has come in. There's a season here. There's a season here for the Gentile. We talked about that last week. We weren't raised like Jews where everything was all about God. We were raised like Gentiles where everything was all about us. Right? Thank God we see here there's a season and we happen to live in it. Oh, thank the Lord, right? That we happen to live in it where God opened up everything for us Gentiles, you know what I mean? And here we are. It's so amazing. Here we are. We're standing here at the end of time. We're standing here. I'm telling you, at the church sometimes, you guys don't act like you're the most excited. But I'm going to tell you something. I'm very excited to be living where I'm living right now in this time, in this space, in this place. I tell you about my daughter right now. My daughter, money came like that. She built a big old airplane hangar. She don't have any airplanes. But God was doing something in Peru, and God's going to building a big ministry in Peru. It's just amazing. And as soon as they get the doors open and get going, poof. And what's happened in Peru is because they're so poor and the markets are very close together and more closed marketplaces, they all got coronavirus. They're the 12th nation in total deaths. They're a smaller country, 12th nation in total deaths of all the nations of the world in terms of deaths. It's been awful. They're still locked down to June 30th, and it may be extended beyond that. My daughter's saying, Dad, all the missionaries are leaving. The thing that's happening is they're saying Americans brought the virus to Peru. So there's a little bit of an anti-American thing there. So a lot of missionaries that are in Peru are leaving. 70% of the missionaries in Peru are leaving, and they're leaving forever. Some of Maggie's best friends are gone. They've gone. They've left. They went home. Maggie has a little girl there. We've prayed over the years. Lord, let them get custody of that little girl. Lord, please, let them be able to adopt that little girl, get her, and then they can bring her home. They've not been able to do that. You want to know why? And that little girl's big old anchor in them, you know what I mean? They're not leaving their little girl, so they're like, we're staying. Plus, they begin to realize God has done this amazing thing with this big church building. So they're starting, my daughter's starting to realize that God has us staying and everybody else is going. It's becoming very clear. I can tell she's adjusting her lenses. Does that make sense? I'm trying to get you guys to kind of all adjust your lenses, you know what I mean, on what I'm seeing. Wait a minute. There's a spiritual, whoa, whoa, whoa. what I'm seeing is God's about to do something. When God shakes the whole world, hey, God's about to do something huge. We're on the edge of God doing something great. You're either in or you're out. You're in or you're out. I like that. That's pretty funny, actually, right there. Woo! Hey. Woo, but that's a devil symbol, man. She's like, yeah. Yeah, God's about to do something great. Listen, you young people, God's about to do something great. Hey, you old people, God's about to do something. Tom said a minute ago, he heard they were honoring seniors today. He said, I'm not getting up on that stage. Wrong kind of senior, Tom. You're honoring seniors? I'm not going up there. Anyhow, God's about to do something. Hey, all of you, young lady, God's about to do something great. Old man, God's about to do something great. Hey, kids, God's about to do something great. How'd you get up here? Are you in trouble? No? Okay. God's about to do something great. If there's whippings after church, I didn't want to say God's about to do something great. Hey, church, God's about to do something great. Taking the whole world. He got the whole world. And he's got a timing. I just got to start you guys, huh? Whoa, whoa. He got me and you, sister. Oh. The 2020 grads, he got the 2020 grads. In his hands, he got the 2020 grads. In his hands, he got the 2020 grads. In his hands, he got the whole world. Oh, yeah. That's good. Yeah. God's about to do something big. You know what he's saying right here? It's this idea that, you know, you Jews, you just stand back for a minute. I'm going to bring the Gentiles forward. We're going to do something with the Gentiles. But they're kind of different. They're about them. So I got to pour my spirit down on them. I got to change them on the inside. I got to do something powerful in them to shape, that makes them different. I can't let them be Gentiles. I got to get them to be believers. They got to trust in me now. Right? So Pentecost came along in the New Testament and filled us with the Spirit, right? And what's so crazy, they heard him speak in different languages, right? And all the people from the Gentile world stepped up and said, I heard these dumb fishermen speaking in our Gentile languages. How are they doing that? Even in the languages they spoke, God was already beginning to say, I'm going to go get them. It was a bunch of Jews that day when that all began, but I'm going to tell you something. They spoke Gentile language. I'm just trying to tell you. And the gospel took off out of that place. And Peter got a cloth coming down and went to Cornelius' house and boom, you know. And then Paul took off and he went all over and boom, 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 boom. And the Spirit of God fell upon him. In fact, Peter said in Cornelius, about Cornelius in chapter 10, he said, how can I deny that God has come to the Gentiles? For we heard him speak in a language just like he did with us at first. Right? God's about to do something big. Right? And you know how I feel. There's a first act, and then there's a final act. And, well, this is how, I'm getting so ahead of myself. Anyhow, time of the Gentiles. I can get ahead of myself pretty easy. Haggai. Y'all been hanging out in Haggai? This morning I got hanging out in Haggai. And I'm going to declare something over you. I don't do this very often because I'm not one of these guys that try to be all hyper. Well, I'm hyper, but I'm not trying to be hype in the church. I'm not trying to... And as soon as I hit it, I knew this morning, that's what you're trying to get me. Lord, I've worked all weekend trying to find the verse that you want. Bam, there it is. This blows my mind. I'm just telling you, it's almost a proclamation over our church. It's almost a proclamation over the church in America. For thus says the Lord of hosts. It even says, the Lord says. I like that. Once more. It is a little while. I will shake heaven and earth and seas and dry land. Has God done that? Behold. And I will shake all nations. Now you don't think God's into shaking? And they will come to the desire of all nations. And I will fill the temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The Lord was speaking to Haggai, and he was saying, listen, there's going to be moments. And I almost feel like the Lord's saying, and once again, I'm going to do that. Once again. When he shakes the whole world. That his desire is to fill the temple with his glory. Today is Pentecost Sunday. Today, many of the churches that have been closed across America, even throughout the world, are coming back to church. And I just feel like the word for our church, the word for the real church, the word that what God's trying to do is once. In fact, it's right there. You see it right there. Thus, once more, just for a little while. I shake heaven and earth. It's so where we're at, you know what I mean? I thought, God, that's it. But then he goes on to say, I'll put a desire in them. And I'll fill this temple. I'll fill this. When I heard this temple, when I'm the preacher of this church and the Lord takes me to this verse and it says this temple, I start saying, then do it, Lord, do it, do it. How do you say it? Hallelujah. Glory to God, amen, right? That's what I say. Hey, Lord, bring your glory into this place. Years ago, I put my dog out. You don't need to hear that whole thing again. The Lord told me several things, but the last couple things he said was, and you will see my glory, and then I'll come. And today, the Lord takes me to Haggai. I'm never hanging out in Haggai. I just want you to know, Haggai is like the ghetto. Haggai is not where I'm hanging out. I'm just not hanging out there. You know what I mean? I'm not hanging out there. I shouldn't have said it like that, but I didn't mean it like that. I just tried to say that's not the place I hang out. The Haggai is like a crack house. That didn't help either, did it? I'm not hanging out there. It's like the bar. It's not where most people hang out. Not where I hang out. And I will shake the nations. Hey. Hey. Here's the problem, church. Here's the problem. You know what the description of the last days church is? Sleepy, or Luke. The whole earth has been shaken, but the church will be sleepy. La 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 la. Or lukewarm, right? You hear me? God's saying, hey, it's Passover Sunday. I'm bringing all the churches back. Hey, I know I did a great thing, but the whole idea for this generation is I'm going to fill them with my spirit again. I'm going to pour that out on them, and my glory is going to be in the temple. My glory, you're going to see my glory. And I just feel like, I just sense in my heart, God's shaking the world again, you know. And here we are, Pentecost Sunday, and God is going to stir something in us that we haven't had stirred for a long time. And God is going to be God, and we will see his glory. Yeah. That's what you get for hanging out in Haggai. And the silver is mine, and the gold is mine. I just think it's funny that God threw that in here. It all belongs to me. I just want you to know. Hey, you, all you believers, I just want you to know. It all belongs to me. The glory of the latter temple shall be greater than the former. What God's about to do is going to be greater than what he's ever done. You seeing that? That's what you get hanging out in Haggai, man. and the glory of the latter temple, the glory shall be greater than the former. Man, I'm prophesying right over our church. No wonder you're in here with your hands up, man. I noticed it just before we went to coronavirus. Listen, it hit me probably November last year. Well, there was a Sunday. I sit near the front where Loretta's at. I was sitting there one day on a Sunday morning. I actually came back. I sit there in the first service. I came back to that spot in the second service to see if I'd have the same experience. And I just shut my mouth. And I just put my hands up, and I was just trying to listen. And in late November last year, I started hearing our church sing like it's never sang. I said, God, you're starting to do something. You're starting to do something. Lord, you're starting to do something. And I could feel in my heart. I knew that thing about what God had told me. I'd see his glory. I knew we were getting to the place where we're getting close to the end. I knew God was about to do. So I'm just like, oh, God, do something. And the whole time people were just singing. I'm going, God, do something. Lord, move in this place. God, you're raising up a praise from your people. Lord, come on. Come on. Bring them. Bring them, Lord. Bring them. Bring them. Bring them. Bring them, Lord. Bring it. Coronavirus. Poosh. Brrr. Mark, teach it off of TV. Oh. I taught Revelation because I think there's such bad teaching out there in Revelation. And I began to teach Acts because I felt like the church needed to hear the amazing story of how the church began. But I'm telling you, that was former, this is latter. There's a former reign, there's a latter reign. And this verse says, and the latter will be greater than the former. Have you heard what your Bible said about the miracles and things that happened in the early church? Have you seen it? And this is saying, it will be greater in the latter days. I want to do this thing where I'm not this solemn, oh God of the heavens. I'm just like, Lord, bring it. Lord, just bring it down on us, Lord. I'm just a country boy, you know what I mean? Saying, God, if you got it, I need it, Lord. Just pour it out on us. Lord, we love you with all of our heart. We belong to you. Our life is not worth living without you. Right? You give me 1,000 reasons to say thank you every day. You show me over and over and over how much you love me. You make it easy, Lord, for me to tell you I love you. Right? God, bring it. You said it. It's your word. Bring it. I'm not asking you to do something, Lord, you didn't say you would do. I'm just saying, God, do what you do here or in my life, Lord. Right? Man, I'm over time. Gosh. Oh. And it shall come to pass. Let's play that video and we'll get out of here pretty quick. I've got a couple minute video for you. It's Acts 2. Just listen. Listen what the Lord is trying to say in Acts 2. Hit it, brother.
On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem, and when they heard the loud noise, everyone came running. They were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages, and we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done. They stood there, amazed and perplexed. What can this mean? They asked each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, they're just drunk, that's all. Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all of you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem.
Make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit, even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. And I will cause wonders in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark, and the moon will turn blood red before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Acts 2. We're the church. What a great and glorious place to be, right? Where God is speaking. He'll pour his spirit out upon us in those last days and all flesh. Our sons and our daughters are going to start prophesying. Young men will see visions and old men dream dreams. And upon my men servants, upon your male servants, in that day there were slaves, and they thought even the least, even among the least, that's what this is saying, even among the least of the men and women, the servants, even the servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. And I'll show wonders in heavens. You've heard this on this thing, signs on the earth beneath blood and fire and moon smoke. La la la, it turned the darkness, moon to blood before the great coming of the day, the awesome day of the Lord. It shall come to the pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Last verses. And Peter said to them, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? We repent, and every one of you be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Here we go. And here we go. I'm officially saying to you, hey, the time has come for prophecy to be in the church. And if you have something prophetic to say, I don't want you holding it back. What the Lord has to say is more important than what this guy has to say. Okay? Lord, come and move upon your people. Fill this place, Lord, with your glory. Let that begin today for a little while, Lord. Pour out your spirit, Lord, that even our children prophesy. And show us in visions and dreams, God, the great things that you're about to do. Let people stand in the front of this place, Lord, and let us pray over them. And the power and presence of God heal them and deliver them from whatever may come. Today, Lord, is your day. The beginning day of the end run, Lord. I just sense that in my heart. Stir your people. You've shaken the whole earth. Sometimes, Lord, it's the church that's asleep. We've been preached to so much, Lord, that the next Sunday just seemed like the next Sunday. We can't even have our chairs in their normal place, Lord. You've shaken the earth so much. We've had to move our chair. God, don't let us fall asleep. Hallelujah. The day of Pentecost, 2020. That be the beginning date, Lord, of your great fame on planet Earth. Let it begin today, even in this place, and we'll forever give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody. We love you. Come back again real soon. Would you? Pray. Seek the Lord.
Thanks, Chad. So let's worship. Lord Jesus, be in this place. And Lord, we know you are. And Lord, we don't even know what you're up to. But Lord, we trust in you. And we know that you're doing exciting, amazing things. And Lord, our prayer is that we hear your voice. And Lord, just as this song says, Lord, that we won't do anything if you're not in it. And Lord, let us hear your voice and follow you wherever you go. Lord, thank you for just things working out. Lord, we come to worship you. Today I was thinking about worship. And to some people it really seems kind of silly, you know, that we come in at a church and we sing songs and we play on instruments and what's the big deal? And, you know, there's a lot of different types of music. And I like a lot of them. But the Lord created music, and he created it for his glory. There's different ways to worship with our obedience, with our life, how we conduct ourselves. But he said that if we do not worship him, the rocks will cry out. And I believe with my whole heart that in my life, so many battles have been won as I've had my hands lifted. And as I've honored God and gave him glory. And I think that when we forget to worship and we just sing, we're cheating ourselves. And we're not giving God what he created us to do. He created us to give him glory and to worship him. So we come to worship you, Lord. Yeah. to lift you up, Lord. Mighty King, we worship you. Lord, we do that here in this small group of people, Lord. But your presence is here. We choose to worship you. We choose to worship you, God. Lord, you make us vessels. The Bible is full of stories of vessels. Vessels that were filled with oil. Vessels that were filled with water. Vessels, Lord, that contained very life-giving substances. And Lord, we ask you to fill us. But Lord, it wouldn't be right if we asked you to fill us just so we could be filled and be no good for your kingdom. Lord, pour us out. Lord, pour us out. Lord, these words in this song had no idea what was going to happen this week. And Lord, wherever we go, whether it be here, Minnesota, wherever, God, let us be vessels that pour out your peace and your love and your hope. Praise you, Lord.
Rushing river, let mercy flow through. God, I pray that you just, you speak through Pastor Mark today, and you just give him the words that we all need to hear. I pray for our country. I thank you for the fact that, just everyone showed up tonight to worship you.